Good morning and welcome to St. Thomas's Church of Pendleton, where we are celebrating the Eucharist for the ninth Sunday of the Trinity. The service is led by me, Daniel Burton, and our deacon is our team assistant curate, Clive Hamilton. This is a team service, and it's very good to welcome people in church from the congregations of our team, St. Luke's, St. Edmund's, Holy Angels, Emmanuel, and St. Thomas's. Welcome to friends far and wide who are worshipping at home and joining us via social media. Sorry that we're slightly late in the beginning this morning, we've had a few technical problems with our technology. I need to give a few practical details about the service. Please take your time as you move around the building and do give other people plenty of room. Please note that face coverings are now mandatory and should be worn by all those attending the place of worship. Those leading worship, reading and praying are allowed to remove their masks when they are leaving from mid-worship. There'll be no singing in this service. We're going to listen to the hymns which have been recorded by the choral scholars of St. Martin in the Fields in London. There'll be no physical contact, no shaking of hands. When it comes to Holy Communion, we will receive in one time only. There will be two communion points, here at the chancel step for those downstairs, and in the gallery this week because of the work that's going on in the north porch. So you'll be invited to receive communion in the gallery if you'd like to do so. Please wait to be directed to the appropriate place. After the service, please stay in your seat until asked to leave by the wardens. There can be no refreshments at the moment, and I think at the moment we are also discouraged from talking to our friends because of the current restrictions in Greater Manchester. Finally, we are broadcasting the music in this service under our CCLI Imperius for Music Church License, number 122-1681. Let us now worship God as we enjoy our first hymn, which is Jesus Calls Us for the Tune. Together in the name of the Father, the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We say together our prayer of preparation. Almighty God,
to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Let us then show our love for him by confessing our sins in penitence and in faith. We have not always worshipped God our Creator. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
We have not always followed Christ our Saviour. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
We have not always trusted in the Spirit, our guide. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you, forgive you your sins, and bring you to everlasting life. In Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. As God's forgiven people, we praise God with the words of the glory. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. As we stand, let us pray the collect for the ninth Sunday after Trinity. Almighty God, who sent your Holy Spirit to be the life and light of your Church, open our hearts to the riches of your grace, that we may bring forth the fruit of the Spirit in love and joy and peace. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and raised with you, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
The Lord is not in the fire. sheer silence. When Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. Then there came a voice to him that said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He answered, "I have been very zealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the Israelites have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. I alone am left, and they are seeking my life to take it away." Then the Lord said to him, "Go, return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus. When you arrive, you shall anoint Hazael as king over Aram. Also, you shall anoint Jehu, son of Nishmi, as king over Israel. And you shall anoint Elisha, son of Shaphat, of Abel-Olam, a prophet in your place. Whoever escapes from the sword of Hazael, Jehu shall kill. And whoever escapes from the sword of Jehu, Elisha shall kill. Yet I will leave 7,000 in Israel, all the knees that have not bowed to God, and every man that has not kissed him." This is the word of the Lord.
We listen to our second hymn, "At the Dawning of Creation." Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go ahead to the other side while he dismissed the crowds. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up the mountains by himself to pray. When evening came, he was alone. But by this time the boat, battered by the waves, was far from land, for the wind was against them. And early in the morning he came walking
terrified, saying, "It is a ghost," and they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I, do not be afraid." Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." He said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat and started walking on the water and came towards Jesus. But when he noticed the strong wind, he became frightened and began to sink. And he cried out, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying to him, "You of little faith, why do you doubt?" When they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be now and always acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our renewal.
Amen. Amen.
What's the difference between a ship and a boat? Well, you can fit a boat on a ship. A ship can carry a boat if you like, but not the other way around. I guess you can row a boat. I'm not sure that you can row a ship. I've been thinking about boats because of the desperate scenes from the English Channel that have been on our TV screens this week. But also, of course, because of this morning's gospel story. And I remember that there's actually a ship on the middle of the coat of arms of the city of Salford, testifying to the historical importance of shipping and waterways to our own city. Now that might be surprising to an outsider, but of course not to somebody who knows about the history of the Bridgewater Canal or the Manchester Ship Canal. Shipping has been very important for this city. But boats, of course, are symbols of something else, and that is the Christian Church. It's a symbol that goes back to the earliest days of Christianity. The Church was compared to Noah's Ark. The boat and the anchor were very early Christian symbols. And as we know, the very place that you are sitting in this morning is called a nave. A nave is a word that comes from the Latin navis, which literally means a boat or a ship. So when Jesus' disciples are straining against the oars in that gospel reading we just heard, early Christians would have seen that as an allegory or a metaphor for their own community, gathered together in a vessel that was being continually tossed upon the waves, guided by a Saviour who was always one step ahead of them, leading them safely back to home. In a sense, the image of a boat on the waves becomes an image of our journey through life. We're all taking part in this pilgrimage across the ocean of the world, over storm-tossed seas, until we finally come to the safe harbour of the world to come. It's interesting that we often speak about the next world as that other shore. The boat is our home, our shelter, our community, the place where we encounter our fellow passengers who journey with us through life. But in today's gospel, Peter steps out of the boat. Matthew is the only one who tells this particular story. And in today's story, Peter is doing quite well, until he forgets the first lesson that you learn when doing something dangerous: don't look down. When he does look down, he sees the wind and the waves whirling around him, and he panics. "Lord, save me!" And of course Jesus does. But Peter also earns a gentle rebuke from his teacher. "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" And it raises a very interesting question. Was Peter's mistake looking down and doubting that he could actually do what Jesus did? Or was Peter's mistake the request to be able to walk on water in the first place? In other words, is Peter being rebuked for his lack of courage or for his need for proof? Should he have just stayed in the boat all along and trusted that that ghostly figure that he was seeing really was Jesus? The way we answer that question will tell us a lot about what we think faith is in the first place, what kind of faith we want to have or think that we ought to have, what kind of faith we think we may lack, what kind of faith maybe we used to have but don't have anymore. Some people understand faith as a kind of white-knuckled grip on the things that we think we ought to believe, the things that we ought to do in Jesus' name. The kind of faith that tells us, I can believe 99 impossible things before breakfast. The kind of miraculous things that don't always seem to make much sense in the world. Things like when Jesus tells me to walk on water, I ought to be able to do it, without any doubts or second guessing. That is a very black and white view of what faith is. And it can be very hard on the Peters of this world when they have a crisis, when their courage fails and they start to sink. In that context, faith and doubt are two polar opposites. One to be embraced against all odds, and the other to be rejected at any cost. In that framework, the goal of the religious life is to perform the miraculous, to walk on water, just like Jesus did. But there's a different view, isn't there, as well? Maybe faith is not a determined, courageous, confident belief in the miraculous. Perhaps faith has a much more everyday quality about it. Something that has much more to do with how we live our lives from day to day. Much less with fantastic feats of strength and power. Maybe faith isn't walking on water. Maybe faith is making the decision to stay in the boat. Lord knows, many have got out of the boat. What kind of faith does that look like? Well, you might say a bit boring. But that might be the point. It's a faith that asks us to resist the urge to be spectacular. And instead to embrace the moments in our lives when we do have fears and anxieties and lack of courage. After all, isn't that what Jesus did in his temptations in the wilderness? He resisted the temptation to be spectacular. He chose to be vulnerable. It means, this kind of faith means that we leave the walking on the water to the one who does it best, and that's Jesus. And that we embrace our own role as members of Jesus' team, as comrade sailors, as it were. And that embedded in communities that, yes, demand a great deal of us, but also give us a great deal in return. It means that we embrace the relationship that God has given us here, in this moment, in this community. Not go rushing for different ones, better ones, in a different place. In this way of reading the story, Jesus has rebuked Peter, "Oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt?" It comes not as a response to his fears about crossing the water, but in failing to recognize Jesus in the first place. "Lord, if it is really you, command me to come to you." It may be that Jesus doesn't much care whether we can really walk on water or not, but he does ask that we get better at recognizing him when he comes to us, when he appears. Whether that's an incredible apparition, walking across water, something that seems to make no sense in our world, or whether it's the ordinary down-to-earth moments when Jesus appears, our opportunities to recognize him in our everyday Jesus appears in the most surprising and yet ordinary of places. He's next to us on buses and trains. He's out there in the streets of our city. He's in hospital. He's in prison. He's in places of great anguish and places of great joy. And in that sense, every moment of our lives is a moment to walk on water, to encounter Jesus on the stormy seas of our chaotic world. And in those moments, to hold out our hand, to take his hand, and to be escorted back onto the boat. That's where Jesus and Peter end up. Jesus takes Peter's hand and leads him back to his seat on the boat, sits him down. Oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt? Why did you feel the need to prove something spectacular to me? I don't need you to be spectacular, Jesus says. I don't need you to work miracles. I need you to stay in the boat, to work your hardest alongside your brothers and sisters in helping to steer it safely into harbour. According to that reading of the story, the work of faith then becomes not the proof of the belief that we think Jesus demands of us, but rather a simple practice whereby we learn to recognise Jesus when he sits right next to us, where we are, the very place where Jesus is likely to show up, and maybe, just maybe, work an everyday, normal, boring old miracle. Today, we are welcoming new members into the boat of the Christian faith. After this service, you are all welcome to stay behind and join us outside as we witness the baptism of 17 adults and 2 children from our Farsi community. They've waited a long time for their baptism. They should have been baptized at the Easter Vigil. And that, of course, would have been wonderful. But we hope that this different pattern of baptism today will be equally impressive and memorable. We've already done a life-changing thing for these individuals. We've introduced them to the captain of the ship, Jesus. The hard work comes next, helping them to grow in their love for the captain and for their fellow sailors. It is, of course, the greatest gift that we could have given them. And we now have the opportunity to teach them some life-changing, life-saving skills. Together, may we all be found faithful to our captain until that day when he brings us safely to the other shore, to that greater light. Amen. We'll just keep a short time of silent reflection before our intercessions, which are being led by Joe.
As we encounter God's stillness and silence amidst the uncertainties and chaos of our daily lives. When, like Elijah, we feel confused, isolated, or alone, may we find in the stillness of God the assurance that we are members of a wonderful worldwide family of faith in Christ. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
On this day when we commemorate Mary Sumner, founder of the Women's Union, let us use that organisation's prayer, followed by Mary's personal prayer. Loving Lord, we thank you for your love so freely given to us all. We pray for families around the world. Bless the work of the Mother's Union as they seek to share your love through the encouragement, strengthening and support of marriage and family life. Empowered by your Spirit, may we be united in prayer and worship, and in love and service reach out as your hands across the world. And now Mary's personal prayer. For this day, O Lord, let me touch as many lives as possible for thee. And every life I touch, do thou by thy Spirit quicken or enliven, whether through your word, whether through the word I speak, the prayer I breathe, or the life I live. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
And today, as we think of family life, we would like to give thanks for the safe arrival of Ruth's grandson, Eli Bobby Whitfield. We thank you for the church across the world. Bless her leaders with wisdom and compassion, and guide her in worship and service. We pray for Christians who are persecuted, that your presence will strengthen and uphold them in their ordeal, and bring them relief and freedom. Here in Salford, we pray for Bishops David, Mark and Mark, for the clergy and congregations of the Deacon and the Salford All Saints team. We thank you for the imaginative and innovative ways in which we have been able to maintain our connections and identity as church, and ask for your continuing guidance as we move forward in changing circumstances. Lord, in your mercy. We thank you for the beauty and bounty of your amazing world. As we become more aware of how our misuse of resources and habits of excess have damaged and degraded our environment, teach us how to tread lightly on the good earth and contribute by restraint to a more just and equal sharing of nature's nurture and provision. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for the people of Beirut, whose lives have been devastated by such an enormous explosion. We pray for all who are now homeless and, after the initial shock, extremely angry about decades of corruption that have led to this disaster. We ask that the people will come together and channel that powerful emotion into positive ways to bring justice and renewal to their land. May the provision of foreign aid be properly targeted to be the help and support it is intended to be. Lord, in your mercy. We thank you for our families, friends and communities. We thank you for all the love and support we have received in these difficult times, and ask that your Holy Spirit will brood over our communities, nurturing concern and respect among neighbours, and loving stability and family life. Lord, in your mercy. We thank you for our health and well-being, and all those who provide medical and social care. And we pray for those who are sick. We pray for those on the sick list of our various churches, including Habib and Sarah, who ask for comfort and protection. Lazadis, who has friend in Croydon, for her healing and comfort. Pauline Dunstrey. And we pray for those who are in our individual hearts and minds, and those whose needs are known to you alone. We ask you to bring healing of body, mind and spirit to all who are unwell at this time. Lord, in your mercy. As we ponder the stillness of God, guarding silence. You are invited to bring your personal thanks and requests to that deep well of love and refreshment. We hold before you, especially this morning, all those who are to be baptized today, asking you to keep them in your love and mercy. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
We thank you for those who have meant so much to us, but have passed through death into God's near presence on the other shore. We remember all who have died recently, and include with them Tony Morris, and those who have died during the present pandemic, and those who lost their lives in the daily class. We also remember those whose anniversary of death occurs at this time. So we pray for all who mourn, those whose grief was recent and very long, those whose grief has eased with the passing of time, and those whose grief persists for months and years. Bring them the comfort of your immeasurable love, and by your Holy Spirit, bring us all with the faithful to your glory everlasting. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Rejoicing in the fellowship of St. Aidan, St. Ambrose, St. Anne, St. Luke, St. Thomas, and all saints and holy angels, we commend ourselves and all for whom we pray to the mercy and the protection of God. Merciful Father,
accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Would you please stand for the peace? We are the body of Christ. In the one Spirit we were all baptized into one body. Let us then pursue all that makes for peace and builds up our common life. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of peace.
Please be seated as we enjoy our next hymn, Dear Lord and Father of Man. praying for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me.
Let us proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
And so Father, God, to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people, and gather them to one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we in the company of Blessed Mary, St. Thomas, St. Anne, St. George, St. Luke, St. Adam, and all the saints and holy angels may praise and glorify you forever. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever.
Amen.
The body of Christ broken for you. that new world where you reveal the fullness of your peace. Gather people of every race and language to share in the eternal banquet of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
We pray together.